And welcome into another edition of the Open Up Mic podcast. Bobby Rosensky with you, along with Charlotte 49er Athletic Director Mike Hill. We'll be joined by Deshaun Jackson here in a little bit, of course, on the basketball team as the stretch run here for Charlotte 49er basketball. But, Mike, good afternoon. How are you?
Doing great. Good to see you.
Good to see you. And we talked about this a few weeks ago, but for me, it's always one of the fun times of year when you park at the West Deck, walking into Halton Arena, you can hear baseball going on, everything else. What's this time like for you as an AD with so many sports going on, whether they're just starting or just wrapping up?
Well, it's a lot of fun for me and for our fans. It's a lot of work for our staff, you know, because they're spread so thin with so many events at one time. But I do love being able to kind of bounce around from venue to venue to see baseball, softball, tennis. You know, we'll have a couple of track meets, obviously, coming up this spring, and basketball in full sort of, you know, coming down the home stretch now, really.
Yeah.
So it's an exciting time. There's a lot of energy around it, and I love it.
Well, let's start with one of the sports that just kind of did indoor and went pretty well for the women as they are track and field AAC champions. Of course, Coach Bob Olson, one of the best that we can say that's ever been here. Talk about Bob first, and as you came here, got to know him and the job he has done with the track and field program.
Bob is just a grinder. He just puts his head down. He goes to work. He never complains. He doesn't really ask for anything. And all he does is win. And, you know, I mean, it's an amazing thing to watch and witness and admire. I think he's been conference coach of the year over his career 33 times, maybe 34 times now, because he was just named coach of the year for indoor track in the American for the women. So just an incredible job he does. He's a joy to work with. I love talking to Bob right before these big championship meets because he'll tell you what the projections are. And I knew going into the meet that, you know, it was potentially going to come down to us and Rice on the women's side, and he wasn't kidding.
Yeah.
I mean, it really did. And then on the men's side, you know, he thought, you know, there were probably four or five teams that would be in the hunt, but that South Florida was the favorite, and as it turned out, you know, South Florida won the men's side, but we finished second. So we got a first and second place finish. Is really good.
Yeah, it's funny. I talked to him, and he goes, yeah, we're projected at 107 points, and sure enough, it was right there with everything that he did with the analytics and all that stuff that went out. And by the way, 37 combined track and field championships for Coach Olson and what he's done here with Charlotte. Let's go to the women's side as they do pick up the championship in the AAC. What's that mean to pick up a championship here in the new conference?
Well, championships are extremely hard to win. I don't care what league you're in, but you know, clearly we made a step up in joining the American this past year. And we take a lot of pride in every conference championship we won. Last year in Conference USA, we won a school record 8 CUSA championships, which is that's almost half our teams, which that's going to be hard to duplicate anywhere. But indoor track, you know, winning that conference championship, that's our second one of the year in the American. And we, of all the 6 new schools that joined the league this year, we're the only school that's won any conference championships, and we've won 2. So we're really proud of that fact. And I think we've shown that competitively we 100% belong in this league. Even the championships that we maybe didn't quite win, you know, men's and women's cross country both finished second. Men's outdoor or indoor track finished second. Men's basketball fighting for a top 4 seed. It's impressive. It's really impressive and exciting to see.
Yeah, there were 16 all-conference performances from this weekend. This was back in February for the Charlotte 49er men's and women's in the indoor track and field AAC championship. Patient Marshall set the school record for the shot put. And, of course, Riley Phelps, pole vault, does a tremendous job. Not only school record, but also American Conference record performance.
I feel like every single meet that we compete in, Riley sets a new record. It's incredible. It's, you know, and so excited to watch Riley have a chance to compete, you know, at nationals, and just hope and pray that the Niners can have a big time performance there with her, because what she has done here already is just absolutely remarkable, and we're extremely proud of her.
Yeah, when Deshaun joins us, I know you're going to ask him what other sport he could play. I thought shot put might be something Deshaun Jackson.
I know Biff would like him to play tight end. I said, Biff, stay away.
I can see the tight end, a little LeBron James, maybe what he was able to do if he played. Well, speaking of Coach Poggi and the football, obviously spring practice getting ready to go, the spring game coming up in April, but we got the schedule recently, and that's always an exciting time for me, scoping out the road trips and where we are going.
Sure.
Throughout the year. But I think as a schedule from a fan, Mike, you have to love what this team has, home and away, because if you're looking to go to a road trip, I don't think there's a bad city on the list for the team this year.
It's an awesome schedule. It's a tough schedule.
Yeah.
But it is exciting from a fans' perspective and also for our players and coaches to go compete. But, you know, open up the season at home against James Madison. And we all know James Madison had a great year last year and historically a very tough football team. Brand-new football coach there, Bob Chesney, who did an amazing job up at Holy Cross. I have a lot of respect for him, so it'll be interesting to see, you know, the Dukes and their sort of their new look. And then, of course, we go on the road the next week to Chapel Hill for our first ever gridiron battle with the Tar Heels. Cannot wait for that experience. Should be a lot of fun. Then we come home for Gardner-Webb and then back on the road for another Power 5 opponent, Indiana. So that's our non-conference schedule. Exciting for sure. And then our conference schedule begins the next week, and we go to Houston to play Rice, who beat us here last year. We beat them there the year before, so hopefully we can turn the tables and then talk about a great trip. Our basketball team just had one. I had a chance to travel with them to go to Memphis and hang out on Beale Street.
Never been there, so I'm looking forward to that.
You will love Memphis. Memphis, great barbecue, great music, a lot of fun. That'll be a fun trip as well. And I left out in between, I'm sorry, after Rice, we actually come home and play ECU, kind of a big one to leave out. ECU is our conference opener on October the 5th, and so that'll be a huge game. There won't be enough tickets. There won't be enough beer. We'll have to figure all that out, and I can't wait for that.
Yeah, Navy going there for the first time, obviously it was cool when they came here last year and everything that surrounds that program.
Yeah, after the open data, after ECU, we go to Navy and go to Memphis back-to-back. And Navy, Annapolis, if you've not been, go. It is breathtakingly beautiful, and just to play a service academy, it's such a cool thing to be in a league with now two, with Army's addition. We don't play Army this year, but they'll be on the schedule in the future. And so, you talk about great back-to-back trips, Annapolis and Memphis, two very different trips. But for our fans, I really encourage you to experience that because it's special.
Yeah, I already looked up when we go to Rice. I was checking the Astros schedule, but unfortunately, they're out of town there that final weekend of the season. Then Halloween night, Thursday night to close out the month of October. That's going to be exciting, kind of standalone type game for this program to host against obviously a very good Tulane team.
National television, will be fantastic, and the network that'll get released a little bit later. But to have a chance to play a program like Tulane that 2 years ago won the league and beat Southern Cal in the Cotton Bowl, and this past year went undefeated again in regular season conference play before losing in the conference championship. So tremendous respect for them as well. And they've got a new coach as well. They hired from Troy, John Summerall, an excellent coach. So that'll be a tough test for us. But I'm sure we'll have a lot of fun activity around a Halloween night game on our campus. And I know our students will be ready to go.
Yeah, and then obviously the weekend off, and actually the next week off too before USF here at FAU. Never a bad time to go to Boca in November, to say the least, and then UAB. And that's a Friday, Saturday, kind of depending on what the, I guess, standings are as we move along through the season. And one other note there, of course, JMU, the new coach, as you mentioned, their coach went to Indiana. So we will see both parts of that as we go apart this year.
It's exactly right, you know. So it's interesting, the schedule is challenging. The opponents are challenging. And also, I think the format is difficult because three of our first four conference games are on the road. But the flip side of it is three of our final four home games are at home. And honestly, I love that. I mean, I think we'll certainly be battle-tested, road-tested by the time we get into that home stretch there with Tulane and UAB and USF.
I think it's similar as last year. I don't want to say we had three out of five on the road to start the year, and then we got to October, and there weren't as many road trips that we had to navigate through the rest of the year. Just the football team as a whole, obviously year two for Coach Poggi, this staff. Where's your excitement level here as we get set to get going here in 2024?
High level of excitement, man. I love a lot of the additions that have been made to the roster. I think, you know, certainly securing a quarterback of the caliber of a Max Brown, who was the number two quarterback at Florida but ended up starting the last game against Florida State, through, I think, 19 to 28 for almost 200 yards against one of the best defenses in the country against FSU. Played the second half of the Missouri game when their starter Graham Mertz got hurt, and I actually happened to watch that game. I came home from our game, turned on the TV, and saw the Gators in Missouri, and I said to my wife, I said, who is this kid, Max Brown? My God, he's really talented. He can throw the ball. He's athletic. He can run. Guy's like 6'3", 225. He's got some size. I met with him on his recruiting visit, met his family, fantastic people. He has the charisma and the leadership skills, I think, that's required to lead. And you have to have that to have a chance behind center. So we've added some receivers as well, which is obviously important. And so I think, you know, if we can meet the standard defensively that we did a year ago and just ratchet up the offense a little bit, it could be an exciting season. That's what we're looking forward to.
I know coaching staff, just about everyone back, and obviously Coach Osborne there on the defensive side, I didn't think did a heck of a job last season. So exciting here again. Spring practice about ready to roll. Spring game will be in April, but we are winding down here with basketball season. Hard to believe basketball season is getting ready to wrap up here, but as you've just looked at both men's and women's, what have you made here of this 2023-24 season?
Just tremendous pride in both programs because, look, when you consider where both of them were projected in the preseason, it's pretty impressive. I think the women were picked maybe 10th and the men were picked 13th. Mm-hmm. So I think that the competitive spirit that our teams have shown has been really remarkable, and it's been fun to see. Our crowds have been great. There's been a lot of energy and enthusiasm, and I can't wait to see us come down the stretch and head into conference tournament play.
Yeah, looking forward to that out in Fort Worth here later on this month. Well, let's look at the men's team a little bit more. And Fernville was set up outside the Halton Arena prior to that game against ECU, a sellout crowd. What was that like for you to see that? I know basketball is maybe number one in your heart, so to see that environment back here that fans have been craving for in Halton Arena.
It was special. I think for all of the fans who've been a part of this place for a long time, it brought back some great memories of sort of the heyday and the magic of Halton Arena. And for those like me who were newer to the program, to see it and experience it and to understand was amazing. It reminded me a lot of some of the biggest atmospheres I've been lucky enough to be a part of in my career in the SEC and the ACC, and I've told many people that. It was loud. It was enthusiastic. Our students were just off the charts in terms of their energy level. And that's a game that I don't think any of us will ever forget because not only did we have an amazing crowd, but we also competed hard, won a game against a rival by 15 points on national television. It was a two-hour commercial for our university and our program, and we'll never forget it.
And I just know working with Joby Thomas, of course, Niner great, and he was there able to enjoy the game as an alum for Alumni Day and all that stuff. And working with him for years, he was still talking about it weeks later and the excitement level that he had to see that program. And I know he mentioned all the other alums that were back, former players, excited to see what was going on. And we was looking for this tournament, Mike, as we gear up here to go to Fort Worth for men's and women's here, where's your excitement level? Because it does seem, we were talking about here before we started this episode, it doesn't really matter to me where you are in the standings. Obviously, you want to be top four because it's less work you have to do in Fort Worth, but it seems like you could look top of the standings, you could look bottom of the standings, and you know every single team has an opportunity to pick up a win.
Well, they do. It's an extremely difficult league on both sides. I mean, I think right now on the women's side, there are like eight or nine teams within a game or two of each other. It's crazy, right? And on the men's side, we've seen unbelievable parity, and we've seen a lot of the lower teams in the standings knock off teams in the upper part of the standings and some near misses. I think about UTSA, who lost like an overtime at Memphis, okay? Yep. And we saw how good Memphis can be when they're playing at the top of their game. They also had FAU beaten at home and then last second lost that game. Listen, there are no easy games in this league. And so you can't assume, even if you end up getting a top four seed, that you're going to skate through. Really, the benefit is it's just one less game you have to win to win a championship. But it's going to be hard. Mm-hmm. You know, there are a lot of teams that you could see right now in the standings on both sides and saying they're capable of winning the tournament. The good news is the Charlotte 49ers are both capable of winning the conference tournament on the men's and the women's side, and that's awesome.
There's no doubt about that. And, of course, you do that. That punches your ticket to the NCAA tournament. Now, you guys are hosting the NCAA tournament. You mentioned there's so much going on, so I'm sure this is just an easy piece to slide in here as we'll look forward to the Spectrum Center and that. But what's that process like as the host school for the NCAA tournament?
Well, it's a lot of work, and the reason that we do it is really – there are multiple reasons. One is that it just brings a lot of prestige and notoriety to the institution, right? Our logo will be in the corners of the court for national television. There's a chance to associate ourselves with really the sort of the crown jewel of the NCAA. There's an opportunity to generate some revenue for the program as well. So there are a lot of reasons, but the work that goes into it, and it's not just, you know, a month before the tournament. This is literally years of work. And that's been spearheaded by Reagan Hill, who is our Executive Associate Athletics Director. Not that Reagan has any spare time, but she's doing this sort of as, you know, as a side gig almost for us. And it's been really, really cool to watch her sort of organize this with a staff of people who are pros at it. You know, Chris Thomason and Scott Bird have done this a million times. We've hosted before. Darren Spies, Tom Whitestone, others. So we have people on our staff. We're blessed to have people on our staff who've done this, and they understand what goes into running a first-class event. The NCAA loves coming to Charlotte to host the event. Number one, it's a great basketball city, great venue. But they also have faith and trust in our staff and also the organizations that we partner with, the Charlotte Sports Foundation and the CRVA and other partners in the community who work with us to pull it off. So we're excited about it. Ticket sales are, you know, incredible. It's going to be a tough ticket. I wish the Charlotte 49ers could be in that site, but if we're fortunate enough to win the conference tournament and make the NCAA tournament, we're not allowed to play in the home city site. So that would put an additional strain on the staff. But I did tell Reagan, hey, listen, good luck running because I'm going to be with the men's basketball team.
I would expect that. And I believe, I don't know if it was the last time, that was Virginia UMBC, right, if I'm not mistaken, was at the Spectrum Center.
It was.
As you guys
My first weekend on the job.
Well, that was quite a week.
It was my first weekend on the job. Yeah, I'll never forget that. It was crazy.
Yeah, I remember talking to Ryan McGee, ESPN writer. He was there covering. He left. He goes, well, that, you know, 116, that's not good. Because that was the 9:30 game, I want to say it was. And then all of a sudden he was out on a date night with his wife and had to come running back to the Spectrum Center as UMBC did pull off what now we see more common, I guess, in college basketball. But look forward here to the NCAA tournament. So basketball nearing an end, but we got baseball and softball. They are getting going. We already saw softball go to Tallahassee, knock off Florida State. Baseball had the come-from-behind win against West Virginia. Did the same thing against Wofford recently. Where's your excitement here as these two programs and what they did last year and kind of building off that here for 2024?
Well, first, I love seeing the enthusiasm around both of those programs. The crowds that we've had at both of those ballparks early in the season have been fantastic. You know, baseball has put together a monster schedule. They played Virginia Tech, 3-game set. 4-game set with West Virginia. I mean, that's 7 games against some serious competition. We've got Maryland coming into the ballpark here next, you know, the following weekend. So there's a lot of excitement about the quality of opponents, and we're competing with them, you know. And West Virginia won the first 2 games of the series, and we came back and won the next 2, right? So we split with an NCAA tournament caliber team for sure. And then on the softball side, you know, Ashley just continues to do what she does, and that is go on the road and knock off Giants. You know, last year we went to Athens and beat Georgia. This year we opened the season in Tallahassee and beat Florida State, who was the national runner-up last year, which is an incredible extra inning win. And we got all kinds of great publicity about that. So, and we don't shy away from competition. Bottom line is, you know, both of those coaches believe in playing the best in the non-conference to prepare you for conference play. And the crowds that we get at those 2 stadiums are really outstanding. So if you've never come out to watch our softball or our baseball team play, I promise you, you will not regret it. It's an incredible experience. We compete our tails off, and we're really good.
And you got the new bleachers, right? Softball out in right field, because I remember it was a couple of years ago, and we had a basketball game, so I went over with my son just to try to watch a couple innings. We were legit there. I think there was a little creek, and we had to, like, stand up on a hill and just peeking through, like, the fence to see because there were so many people at the softball game. So I got to imagine having the extra seating has been a big benefit here early on this year.
It has been. We added about 450 seats in the beyond the right field wall. And so that's given us a little bit more space to be able to accommodate fans because we were often having to turn fans away. The other good news for fans who like a cold beer at a game is you can buy one now. We call it Brew with the Sioux.
That's perfect.
So you can come out and have a cold beer and sit out in the stands and watch the game, and it's been a lot of fun. So excited about both those teams, who, by the way, both projected #2 in their conference, and we'll see how that plays out. Yeah.
And it's perfect right across the street from each other. So you can, if they're both playing on a weekend, you can just make your way back and forth, and it is perfect. Well, if you don't have enough going on, there is a new team getting ready here next academic year, and that is women's lacrosse. So where's your excitement there as that program gets ready to get started?
You don't very often have a chance to be a part of launching a new sport. And so we're so excited about lacrosse and that the commencement of that season next year. We actually have 8 athletes on our campus right now who are training, because obviously you don't want to bring in one giant class of freshmen in year one, right? And so our head coach, Claire Short, is fantastic. We hired her from Queens, where she had been in 3 Final Fours as the head coach, and she has come in and just absolutely lit the world on fire in terms of recruiting, building a program, building a team. We'll be playing our games at Jerry Richardson Stadium. So we have a chance, really. Our expectation is the home opener next spring. We want to set an attendance record for first-year programs, and what we can, and we think we can draw several thousand fans to that match because we know Niner Nation will be behind these young women.
No, I think I saw some of them out there at a basketball game throwing T-shirts with their lacrosse sticks into the crowd, which was pretty cool to see. So a lot going on here with Charlotte 49er Athletics. But we'll switch gears now, get back to basketball and what's going on with the Charlotte 49er men's side as we welcome in Deshaun Jackson, Charlotte 49er big man who's having a heck of a season for this team. Mike?
No. Good, man. How are you doing?
I'm excellent.
Well, we're glad to have you, DJ. Thanks for joining us. I think you might have just finished an exam, so hopefully that went well.
Yes, sir.
I love it. Student athletes first around here at Charlotte, right?
Absolutely.
That's what we do. So, hey, just love having a chance to visit with you and talk about your experience here as we kind of head down the home stretch into conference tournament play soon. You know, what's it like been for you, you know, playing in such a competitive conference as the American?
You know, I think it's an adjustment coming from the Pac-12. You know, the guys play a lot faster. They play a different type of basketball. I think it's more teams are much more well-rounded instead of like having two dominant teams in the conference. So I think it's been a major adjustment, but I've adjusted well.
That's awesome. Yeah, for sure. And I think we were talking earlier about just sort of the depth of the league, right? It doesn't matter if you're playing the top team or the bottom team in the mm-hmm. league. It's hard, isn't it?
Absolutely. Everybody plays very hard. Everybody plays very fast, poised, and I think that's just a testament to how good our league is.
So as a transfer, tell us about that experience and what that's like to leave a program where you were originally recruited and come into a new place, and how have you been welcomed into the Charlotte community?
The community has definitely been a big part of welcoming me here. I think they definitely welcomed me with open arms, just knowing my situation, knowing what I've been through. Just adjusting to coming from west to East Coast, just getting acquainted to the time zone changes and, you know, going to sleep at a different time and waking up thinking it's 9 o'clock, but it's really 11 o'clock. So, you know, it's the things of that nature, man, but it's all well.
Well, it can be a challenge, I'm sure. It was good to see your dad come out and join us on the road.
Absolutely.
For the Memphis game.
Absolutely.
He's out in California, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's good stuff. Well, I know that, you know, big reason that you decided to stay and play here was Coach Fern. How did you feel? What was your reaction when you heard that we named Coach Fern the permanent head coach?
Oh, man, that was a big thing, man. You know, we've been pushing Fern for a long time. You know, we've been fighting for him, and I think he works just as hard as anybody else. So I think he really deserves it, man, especially seeing how, you know, he took the program in kind of an odd situation, I would say, and turned it to a beautiful thing. You know, things could have went south easily. Things could have went bad. Everybody could have left. But, you know, we stayed, and we bought into what he was trying to do. And it's worked out for us. So, I was big for us.
Well, it's exciting to hear you say that. And I just want to thank you personally for you and your teammates stepping up the way that you did. I think mm-hmm. you all showed a lot of leadership.
Absolutely.
In communicating that to me and to our team. And mm-hmm. obviously, we listened to you.
Absolutely. And, thank you, man.
You bet. And the results speak for themselves. So, mm-hmm. I got to ask you this question before we go into something else. Surely you've got something that you make fun of Coach Vernon for, or you've got an impersonation. What's your best Coach Fern?
Man, he just – if I could say one phrase that he says every day, it's – I could say damn on here.
You just
yes,
did.
You can. yes, you can.
He's always talking about, damn it, LaCoy. He's just always mad at LaCoy, man. But that's my best impersonation.
I love it, man. He calls you mate, right? Calls
yeah,
everybody mate?
Everybody mate. We're all mates, teammates, you know, so –
Has he given you? Have you ever tried any of his favorite candy from Australia, Tim Tams?
Nah, he hasn't brought any of those, and he doesn't want it. Pat's not gonna enjoy
that.
Yeah, Pat's not having that, man.
Well, I told. So Tim Tams are something that he gave me a little box at Christmas time, and it's mm-hmm. an Australian candy, and it's a little bit like it's kind of like a Twix, but better.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, "You got to ration these out because they're so good." And he wasn't wrong. I did a good job of not eating them all at once, but. You know, I told him when I signed him to the contract, I said, listen, it's a 5-year deal, and the only requirement is every year I get a giant shipment of Tim Tams. Okay? So he bought me a box the other day, so yeah. He's good for the next
year. It's like Ted Lasso, absolutely. Right? Where you got to deliver the cookies that he does.
That's it. Exactly right. The Tim Tams are the deal. So, so let's go back a little bit to a few weeks ago mm-hmm. and the ECU game. Bobby and I were talking about this earlier. What was that experience like for you and your teammates and the environment?
Oh, man, it was just different, man. You know, this is my first year playing in Harlem, so I don't know what the crowds are usually like every from week to week. Like, on a yearly basis, I can only say what they've been like from the 6 month basis, and they say this is kind of the most, like, in the last few decades that the guys, the community has came out to support us. So I think, man, that was just a testament to show how much people have bought into what Fern is doing and what how our team plays. And it wasn't shocking, but it was more so just like a surreal moment. Like, wow, like, we're here. Like, it's time to come in and show out. And we did just that. So,
well, and you did, and it was electric in there, and it was absolutely fun to see you go into the stands. How do you like the reverse court storm you guys
did? I like that, man. I think it's safer, you know, because you've been seeing a lot of court storm has gone wrong. And I think it shows our appreciation to the fans instead of, like, the fans always having to come to us, man. It just shows how much we appreciate those guys coming out. We have the best student section.
I agree with you, and I love it, and it's cool to see. So many people probably don't know about you yet outside of basketball. What's mm-hmm. something you want Niner Nation to know about you besides being a great basketball player?
Man, I just to know that I'm not just a basketball player, man. I'm much more than that. I'm only a basketball player for about 3-4 hours out the day. I like to draw. I like to play video games like everybody else. I like going to museums. I like going to art galleries. I think that's what you call them. I read books. I read comics. I read manga. Watch anime. I'm a regular guy, man. So
only 24 hours in a day. That's a lot going on.
I do a lot of stuff, man. So I'm not just a basketball player. I'm not some cool guy. I'll talk to anybody. So
you're a well-rounded guy. I'm impressed by that, man. That's good stuff.
What's the video game of choice?
Oh, probably 2K. Basketball away from basketball.
You create yourself in that game?
Yeah, pretty much. 6'10 guy who can pretty much do a lot of stuff.
That's fun.
Are you excited about the new EA Sports college football game coming out?
Yeah, man. Hopefully they get Biff in there, man, taking his shirt off.
I'm waiting for the basketball game to now make its return. Now they got football. Of course, football is a lot of hurdles, so I'm sure basketball will go that route. But, yeah, football is pretty exciting. Yeah, once I already told my work I'm taking the day off when that game comes out.
No, it's going to be good. And the Niners are at football, will be in that new game, uh-huh. So which is really exciting. So. Mm-hmm. So if you didn't play basketball, what other sport do you think you would have pursued or excelled at?
I always used to play football and baseball as a kid. Playing first base, like just being a big target, being easy for people to find. Like, you know, I'm pretty much getting the ball every play. So, you know, playing that as a kid probably helped me with my hand-eye coordination. And then, you know, probably playing football too, man. I used to be a receiver, but I was a regular sized kid for a long time until about seventh grade. That's when I kind of grew taller than everybody else. I kind of got moved to tight end. So I think I'd probably play football. I'd have to put on a lot of muscle, but I don't think it would be much more of a difference for me just running and jumping, being much more physical. So I think I'd probably play either football or baseball.
So I remember last summer we actually had a Niner Nights gathering, and the football coach was there, mm-hmm. basketball coach, and DJ actually made an appearance with a few other of our athletes. And DJ walked by the table where Coach Poggi was, and Biff looked at me, and he said, "Who's that?" I said, "You cannot have him, all right?" I said, "He's on the basketball team, and he is not going to play tight end for you, okay?"
More two-sport stars right? These days. I know you said baseball. I know Woody does the home run derby with students, right?
Yeah.
Have you thought, can you still knock it out of a
man, we'd have to see, man. I haven't swung a bat in a long time. I had to go to the cages to practice a little bit, but we'll see.
I love it, man. Well, listen, we're so proud of you, DJ. You've done an incredible job as a student and as a player. Our team, we love having you around. Your personality is infectious, and the leadership that you provide to our team is really clear. When I go into the locker room after the game, this is a voice you hear every time. Mm-hmm. And listen, player-led teams are teams that have a chance to win championships. So thank you for what you're doing, man.
Thank you for hiring Fern. Thank you for keeping us here and just allowing us to do what we do.
You bet. Thank you, my friend.
Yes, sir. Thank you, guys.
There you go. DeSean Jackson joining us here on Open Mic. It is episode 2. And just, again, my incredible story, obviously battling his way back to be out there on the court. And huge impact for this team. And as we were talking basketball, obviously Fern getting the long-term deal for it. What was that process like for you here as you saw this play out and just the success this basketball team having this year?
Well, it certainly was exciting and kind of validated the decision we made last summer. That was a tough stretch that we went through, and we've talked a lot about how hard it was on the coaches and the players. I'm going to get in line and say it was hard on the athletic administration and the university. I mean, Chancellor Gaber was amazing in her support of the process, but it was tough, you know, because you want to do the right thing by the players, by the coaches, and also for the long-term health of the program.
Yeah.
But Coach Fern made a compelling case. The players made a compelling case, and they were right, you know. And so as the season unfolded, it became clear to us that he was the guy to lead the program on a permanent basis. And look, there's no handbook on when you're supposed to make the decision when you have an interim. Mm-hmm. Some might say, well, why don't you wait till the end of the season? You could do that, but the truth of the matter is we'd seen enough, okay? We're winning games left and right. We had a school record 8 conference game win streak. We're packing Halton again. Sometimes you can overthink this and outsmart yourself. You know, what are we waiting on here? Like, this is a team pick 13th, right? So I think we feel great about the decision and thrilled to have him and have Fern representing our program and leading these young men. He's a fantastic coach, and I think big days are ahead.
And just quickly brought up the EA Sports College Football video game. I think I remember talking to you guys on a road trip about it maybe a year or two ago. What was that process like, just giving your guys' blessing to EA Sports and everything that goes in to bringing this game back a decade later?
Sure. Well, when we were approached, as were all the other schools, for us it was a no-brainer. Mm-hmm. You want to be a part of that. You want to be included. And I remember playing that game with my son. You know, we pick different teams, mm-hmm. and it's always fun to pick teams that, you know, like, let's have Ohio State come to Jerry Richardson Stadium, right? That'll never happen, right? But we're going to make that happen, and we're going to beat the Buckeyes, right? So it's a fun game, and it'll be really cool, I think, for our fans and for people to be able to see our brand and to be able to celebrate the Niner brand.
It's going to be exciting. Me and Al Wallace have already said we're taking days off to play that game when it comes out. So as we start to wrap things up here, I know fans always want to know what's going on with the Evergreen Master Facility Vision Football Stadium upgrade. So where are we as we look on campus and just improving everything that's going on around here?
Yeah, that's moving along beautifully. We're getting close to wrapping up the advanced planning part of that and get into schematic design. Full steam ahead on that project. Love some of the concepts that have been presented to us and we've discussed to add premium seating to the stadium, which we have none of right now, and really just enhance the overall environment of the facility. It will also give us a chance to have a training table year-round for our football team, which is badly needed. You know, you got 125-plus athletes, and they don't have anywhere they can eat together. So it's exciting to see it come together. And obviously we have some other projects in phase one of the facility plan too, but the focus is to get this thing done and then on to the next. The other project that's in there is a softball field house, softball complex, and that's already been authorized, approved, and designed, and we're looking forward to getting a shovel on the ground on that and get that thing built so that hopefully by late spring of 25 or summer of 25 that it's functional for our softball team.
And we can't talk college athletics without talking NIL, Mike, and I knew that is something new here. There's a NIL collective announced recently for 49er men's and women's basketball. So what can you tell us about the Niner Basketball Collective?
Well, it's a group of supporters who love this place and love this program who've come together to form a collective to support men's and women's basketball, and that's what it takes. It's unfortunate that the NCAA does not allow the schools to go ahead and create these and manage them directly, because if we could do that, this is something we would have done a couple of years ago. But you have to find people who are willing to step up and do it, people who have the passion for it, who have the resources to do it, have the time to do it. And so we're very, very blessed to have some outstanding people, Robbie Lewis, really, and Jill leading that charge to formulate it with some help of some other really great Niners, Randy Peterson, Nick Sulak, Gene Johnson is going to be supportive of it, John Ward. I'm leaving some people out, so I hope I don't offend people. But Robbie really is the one who made this happen, and we're so grateful for him to be willing to get it off the ground for us. You can go online and contribute now at, you know, levels that range from $15 a month up to $4,900, you know, whatever you think you can contribute. And, you know, the rules allow us to promote NIL, and it allows us to promote giving to a collective. So I'm doing that right now. We push that out on social. We'll be, you know, distributing the information to our database as well. And it's important that our fans see what we're doing. It's going to require significant NIL support for our men's and women's basketball teams to succeed the way we want to. If we don't have it, we're not going to win. That's just the bottom line.
And before we wrap up, I know it's going to be a sad day around here after, 37 years, I think. Tom Whitestone hanging it up here with the Charlotte 49ers. I've known him the entire time. Obviously, I've been here. Couldn't have asked for a better guy to help me along, whether it was football or basketball, throughout these years. But you've been here a while now. What's Tom Whitestone meant to this program?
Tom is just the steadiest person that you'll ever meet, right? He never gets too high or too low. He has a great sense of calm about him. He's just a good dude. Mm-hmm. I mean, just a great human being who cares about people. He's about the right things. You can't come up with a single negative thing to say about him. Like, he's just one of those people.
Too nice.
Right? Too nice, right? Yeah, I mean, just as good as they come. And I, you know, if you don't like Tom Whitestone, then you need to look in the mirror. There's something wrong with you, you know? So we're going to miss him, going to miss his wisdom, miss his experience, miss his sense of humor. Mm-hmm. Just his presence. You know, I've learned a lot from him, and I'm grateful for all he's done for me and for us since I've been here. I know Judy Rose would say the same in the job he did, and so just really thankful for him. But look, he's earned it. 37 years, that's a freaking really long time to do anything, right?
Yeah.
And he's earned this retirement, and so, you know, we wish him well. We'll celebrate him and thank him for a job well done. And when he rides off in the sunset in June, then you know, it's on to the next for him, and I'm sure we'll see him in the stands still cheering on the Niners.
I think he can enjoy a gold rush or two as he's hanging out there, and hopefully he can hop on a road trip with us this year for football. Well, Mike, it's been a pleasure once again. I appreciate your time and getting everything we need to know here about Charlotte 49er athletics.
No, it's been great, Bobby. Thanks for having me.
All right, there you go. Open Mike podcast number 2 in the books.